Hi there, welcome back to part two of Do Headstones Speak. I do apologize, it's a little late, but you know, life gets in the way. So in this video, we're going to take a look at the following symbols. We're going to look at doves, wheat sheaves, seashells, wreaths, and my least favorite, the urn. Right, and then at the end, I'm going to show you two photographs of two beautiful monuments that I came across this summer. And we're just going to take a quick look at what those represent as well. All right, so let's go back to the beginning there, to the dove. All right. Again, all of these symbols can be found either on their own or in combination of other symbols on the headstones. So they can be a very simple story or quite complex. All right. But doves. Let's take a look at the birds. No, this type of birds. This type of bird, the dove. Yeah, that's right, the dove. Now we all know a dove is symbolic of peace, right? I think that goes without reason. But there is a religious connotation to a dove, and that is it's representative of the Holy Spirit. Now, doves can be depicted on headstones either flying upwards or flying downwards or at rest or even with a broken ring. And what those mean is flying upwards is the Holy Spirit taking the soul of the deceased up to heaven, ascending to heaven. Flying downwards is the Holy Spirit coming down from heaven to collect the spirit of the deceased. A dove just at rest could just be simply symbolic of the Holy Spirit waiting for the soul of the deceased to take to heaven. Now, the dove that has a broken wing, my understanding is that is represented of children's burials. The broken wing depicting something that has come abruptly to an end. All right. Before its time. Doves can also be seen carved with sprigs of olive leaves in their beak, or maybe a certain type of flower. These all have their own individual interpretations. The olive leaf is an offering. The flowers have their own, as I mentioned, their own individual interpretation. So the flower can be broken, depicting a young life cut short, or it could be a rose depicting love, could be a lily for resurrection, all kinds of things. So those are things that you'd have to kind of like look up to their own individual interpretations, okay? So the next one is the wheat sheaf. Now, initially, this symbol was found only on the graves of people who died after the age of 70, depicting a long and prosperous life. But over the years, of course, like everything else, it started being used on graves of people who died before they were 70 or families. It also, too, has a religious connotation. It stands for the body of Christ, so it has symbolically it represents resurrection and immortality. But it also represents longevity as well as prosperity. And that's why it's very common on family monuments, especially if it was a prosperous family or an individual that was known to be very prosperous and lived to a fairly decent age. So that is a wheat sheaf. Now, I'm cutting these definitions very short, all right, because I could go on forever about what the interpretations are. But I'm just giving you the basics, so you'd have a rough understanding, okay? All right, so wheat sheaf, we've done those. Next one, seashells. Now, this is interesting, a seashell. I never actually saw a seashell on a headstone or carved into a headstone until about 2 years ago when I was stomping around an old Wesleyan Methodist cemetery in Bolton, Ontario. I noticed a row of headstones that had a scallop shell carved into the headstone. And I thought to myself, I'm going to have to go look that up because I have no idea what that represents. And then I came across another cemetery that same year in Bradford, Ontario, where on top of the headstone, somebody had placed two conch shells. And I'd been there for quite some time. They're getting quite brittle. So I thought to myself, what is this representation of shells? Well, apparently shells represent a pilgrimage or a journey. Now, the conch shell is usually placed by someone who has made a journey or a pilgrimage to visit the grave of the deceased. And they place the conch shell on the grave, either on the grave itself or on the headstone, as a symbol or a sign that they have visited. The spirals inside a conch shell depicts the journey, because the journey is never just a straight line. The journey can take twists and turns, and that's what the spirals inside the shell represent. And though they can be carved on headstones, but they are usually placed, the conch shell is usually placed on the grave by someone who is visiting. So it's representative of the pilgrimage that person has taken to specifically go to that grave and visit the deceased. Now, the other shell, the scallop shell, also represents a pilgrimage and a journey. Matter of fact, during the pilgrimages, years, you know, eons ago, pilgrims would line the paths on pilgrimages with scallop shells so that the people coming behind them knew where to go. If you look at the traditions of the Christian baptism or christening, I'm talking, not talking about full baptism, I'm talking about where the minister or priest anoint the baby's head with holy water from the font. They sometimes use a scallop shell or a representative, something that represents a scallop shell. Because the baptism or christening is the start of the pilgrimage or the journey that this child is going to take in life. And that's why they use the scallop shell to bless and name the child in the eyes of God. That's the start of its pilgrimage. Now, just because you're seeing it on a headstone doesn't mean that that pilgrimage has ended. Oh, no. There are certainly people believe that the pilgrimage goes on even after death, that the journey continues. And that's why that shell is on the headstone, because that journey, that pilgrimage is continuing in another, into the great beyond. So I found that quite fascinating. I actually didn't know this until I looked it up a few years back, and to decide, what does that mean? Does it mean they had the love of the sea? Were they nautical? Well, that could represent it too, but it's a symbol of pilgrimage or journey. Yeah. So that's a seashell. I think a wreath is a very obvious symbol. We know, we've all seen them all over the place at cenotaphs, at memorials. You know, you see them on Veterans Day or Remembrance Day. Wreaths are usually round because that circle has no beginning and no end, so it depicts eternal remembrance and memorial. That's basically what a wreath is. It can be comprised of a number of different types of flowers or leaves, and those too would have their own individual meaning. So they can be very simple or quite complicated depending on how they are put together. They can be found in circling monuments or actually carved into the face of the headstone. But it's eternal remembrance and memorial is what a wreath stands for. Now, let's talk about urns. I don't like urns. I just find them incredibly morbid. Even their symbolism is morbid. I don't know what it is. From the time I was very young, you know, as a little girl, my mother would not let me wander into a cemetery or a graveyard unless we had a reason to be there. She was very superstitious. And I remember seeing some of these tall obelisk monuments with the urns plopped on top, you know, either draped or not, and thinking how ominous they looked and scary and frightening they looked. And they've never really been my favorite symbol in a cemetery or graveyard, but it's ironic that there are so many of them, and they were a very popular motif back in the Victorian era. Now, we all know what an urn is. It usually contains cremated remains. And it's a Greek symbol, because the Greeks did cremate their dead, and they put them in ceremonial urns. So what is a symbol of cremation doing in a Victorian burial ground where they did not practice or even believe in cremation, because they felt, they were people that felt you needed your full body for the judgment day. So cremation was, you know, no, we're not doing that. But they were really fascinated with this symbolism. Now, basically, to describe the symbolism, it is the container that holds the last basic or diminished remains of the deceased. So the urn holds the, you know, the basic remains, the ashes of the deceased after cremation. The grave is another. It also represents the grave too, which holds the final remains of the deceased, the bones. Okay. So thank you to see. It's a little bit morbid, and that's, you know. They also, urns will have other depictions of draped urns, broken urn that is depicted as broken. I'm not talking about urns that have been deliberately broken or fallen off due to the elements from their pedestals. Oh, and by the way, just a quick warning regarding safety. Those symbolic urns do fall off those obelisk monuments. They're very precarious. So if you're in a cemetery photographing or whatever, or just looking around, do not lean up against these things. They will and do fall off the top. They're 160 years old or more in some cases. So just be very careful, because if one hits you, it's going to seriously injure you or worse. All right? Just be careful. Don't be leaning up against these tall monuments. All right, back to the urns. A broken urn, one that is actually depicted as broken, is symbolic of a long life that has ended. And then you have the urn that's encircled by a wreath. Of course, you know, the wreath is eternal remembrance, eternal remembrance of the individuals whose last earthly remains are encased in that vessel. Okay. The draped urns are with the, if it's got a frill on it or tassels, it's supposed to be representative of the thin veil between life and death. The one without the tassels, just a plain drapery, is symbolic of the deceased shedding any earthly garments as their soul ascends to heaven, because you don't need clothes anymore, right? So those are the different urns that you will definitely see in a Victorian congregational cemetery. As I say, it's ironic that that symbolism was so popular, but yet they did not practice or believe in cremation. Hey. Okay, so that is covers the main symbols that you're going to see in these congregational cemeteries. As I said before, you can either see them individually or in a combination of, and there's quite a number of interpretations that can be made from these symbols. So, as I said before, that these weren't created by people that were illiterate. These were created by people that were very literate and had, you know, some really complicated and deep beliefs, either the deceased themselves or the families of the deceased, and this is how they wanted them, you know, portrayed, the message they wanted to get across, how they wanted them portrayed in death. Now, before we finish this video, I just want to show you two incredible photographs that I took this year. The first one here is this beautiful memorial for a young boy. This was taken in Aurora Cemetery in Aurora, Ontario. And this is the marker for a young boy by the name of Dennis, who passed away in 1950 at the age of 9. And just take a look at what you see here. You see a beautiful young boy smiling, happy, in play clothes. He's running around, he's barefoot, you know. At the base of the monument by his feet is a beautiful basket of roses, which depicts pure love and veneration. He's holding a bouquet of flowers, different field flowers. He's got roses in it, has primroses and daisies. This is all representative of love, eternal youth and rebirth, and innocence. And notice that there's very little religious connotations here or symbolism in this headstone. It is purely about this young boy. This is what his parents wanted to show, was their young son. And the love that they have and the memory that they want to convey of him. And as I said, his death occurred in 1950. And notice how the symbolism has changed. After the First World War, a number of things changed in society. It seemed to be the catalyst for change. Symbolism in cemeteries also started to change as well. It started moving more towards the individual, not so much religious zeal or belief. Okay, you started seeing more epitaphs that related to the person. And here's a fine example of that in the mid-20th century. Now, the last picture I want to show you is this incredible monument here. I came across this by accident when I went to the place called Midhurst Union Cemetery. I had no idea this monument was here. But as I pulled in the gate, I saw this in the middle of the cemetery. It's not a very big cemetery, but this, you can't help but see this. And it actually quite, it startled me at first. This is the family plot for the Elliott family. And it's also the last, final resting place for their son, Scott Adam Elliott, who he went by the name Adam, who unfortunately died due to, from injuries sustained in a snowmobile accident in 1999. And this is a beautiful effigy of this young man, and it's full size. It's taller than me. And you can see that, you know, here's this young guy with this cheeky, impish smile, kind of standing there leaning up against the stone and say, "Hey, hi, I'm here. Why'd you come over and say hi?" And on the stone, there is a poem that was written by him. I imagine it was a maybe an English class project about describing yourself. And that's exactly what the poem is about. It introduces, he introduces himself, he describes himself, his hair color, his eye color, and he talks about the things he likes, the things he dislikes, his favorite activities, how he enjoys snowmobiling at his grandparents' cottage, and that he lives in Midhurst, and the year is 1999, and at the very bottom is his signature. And this is what his family used to as his epitaph, the poem about himself. And it is such a beautiful memorial, and it speaks volumes. I found when I was standing there, it was almost as if his spirit was standing next to me to say, "Well, what do you think? Do you think that's pretty cool, huh?" That's what I felt. And I've never seen this memorial before. I knew nothing about the tragedy that befell this family. But if it can affect me so profoundly, imagine what it must do to his for his loved ones. You know, I hope it brings a lot of comfort for them when they go and visit him, that they feel that he's there with them and he's still laughing and enjoying himself, you know. And eventually one day, they, judging by the size of the plot, they intend to be with him one day as well. It's just an incredible mar- I've never seen anything like it, and it's going to be one of my favorites for many years to come. So, I hope you enjoyed today's video, and so like I said, this is just the basics, really. I'm just scratching the surface, if it was that, on some of the what some of the symbols represent, okay? There's a lot of information on the internet, some really good books out there that can help you with deciphering or determining the symbolism in the old cemeteries. So if it's something you're interested in, hey, it's a great hobby to have, to go around and just look and take a look at some of the, and try and interpret some of the messages that are on these old headstones. Okay? Anyway, if you do that, remember, this rules, be respectful. Take only pictures and leave only footprints. And until our next story or cemetery adventure, graveyard adventure, this is Sharon saying bye-bye for now.